Good evening, everyone. We welcome you to all Ortho TV Online. And to introduce today's program and today's speakers, I hand over the proceedings to Dr. Thomas.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to Bone School 2020. So Bone School is a monthly teaching program which started in 2012, and it started with the help of my colleagues, Dr. Jayant Sampath, Dr. Subramaniam, and others. And what the plan was to do a monthly teaching program, a full day physical teaching program, not a virtual one. And with each month being dedicated to a separate joint or a separate subspecialty of orthopedics. So we covered pediatric orthopedics 1 month, we did spine 1 month, we did hip 1 month, and we did knee and shoulder, the tumor orthopedics. And we also did some skill sessions, basic surgical skills courses, and advanced orthopedic skills courses along the way every year. So this has been going on since 2012, and we've had faculty drawn from across India who predominantly prominent clinicians who are also great teachers. So with that short introduction, I welcome you to Bone School 2020. And today the theme is pediatric orthopedics, and we're going to discuss the pediatric hip. And I hand over to Dr. Jayant Sampath, who will be moderating this session. Just a little reminder, we'd like to keep this as interactive as possible. So please ask as many questions as you want. You can send the questions to me on my WhatsApp number. It's 9980400858. I'll repeat that again, 9980400858. So if you have any questions, you just say WhatsApp it to me, and then I will ask the faculty and we will get answers to that. So thank you very much for coming. I hope you enjoy the session, and I hand over to Dr. Jayant Sampath.
Thank you, Thomas. It's a great pleasure to be a part of Bone School. I would like to recognize the immense commitment that Dr. Thomas Kishan has had to orthopedic resident teaching. We've been doing this program since 2012, and it is good that even in these difficult times, we are able to cater to the needs of trainees. So today's webinar is about the pediatric hip, and we are going to discuss four topics, namely Perthes disease, slipped capital femoral epiphysis, septic arthritis of the hip, particularly in the neonate and its sequelae, and lastly, DDH. And I am happy to inform you that we have a very experienced and seasoned faculty. Firstly, Professor Hitesh Shah, Professor of Orthopedics from Kasturba Medical College in Manipal, who has inherited the legacy of Professor Benjamin Joseph and is taking the department to newer heights. He has a tremendous interest in Perthes disease, congenital pseudarthrosis of the tibia, skeletal dysplasias, and all the difficult and exotic problems, and they have a wonderful record of academic publication. So I'd like to welcome Hitesh. Secondly, we have Dr. Rudra Prasad, Professor of Orthopedics at Indira Gandhi Children's Hospital in Bangalore. Dr. Rudra Prasad has an interest in clubfoot DDH, and he's also the state coordinator of the clubfoot program. He has a very deep interest in academics, and he has started four pediatric orthopedic fellowships which run at Indira Gandhi Hospital. Dr. Rudra Prasad will be speaking to us about septic arthritis of the hip in children, which is again an important clinical and exam topic. Dr. Mandar Agashe represents the newer generation of pediatric orthopedic surgeons who again has a very he's enthusiastic both clinically and academically. He's the associate editor for pediatric orthopedics for the Indian Journal of Orthopedics, and he's very well published. He will be talking to us about slipped capital femoral epiphysis. A lot of our concepts of about SCIFI are changing, and hopefully he will bring us up to date about these newer concepts. And lastly, I'll be rounding things up, talking about a staple for exams, which is TDH. We also have a quiz which we will be conducting. It's based on the topics, and the faculty have prepared a quiz. So we encourage you all to stay with us to the very end and test your knowledge and understanding from this webinar. So without further delay, I'd like to invite Dr. Hitesh to start sharing his presentation on Perthes disease.
Yeah, thank you, Jayant. Thank you, Dr. Thomas and Jayant, for the opportunity. And can you see my screen, Jayant?
Yeah, we can see your screen, Hitesh. You can start.
Okay. So good evening, friends and colleagues. So I will be talking on the Perthes disease. So the objective of my talk is, what is the Perthes disease? What are the common clinical features? What is the natural history of the Perthes disease? Commonly asked question is for the postgraduates, the radiological features and the common classification. Why need to treat the aim of the treatment of Perthes disease? Points, important words, preventive intervention, corrective intervention, and salvage intervention. Perthes is a very hot topic. 100 years over after it has been invented, still it is a lot of controversies there. I'm not going to involve into the controversy. I will clear the most of the established facts. So I'm not going in the controversy. The first and foremost is the Perthes disease. What is the Perthes disease? It's an idiopathic self-limiting avascular necrosis of the capital femoral apophysis. So if it is following the tuberculosis, infection, inflammation, if avian happens, it would not be considered as the Perthes disease. And commonly it is radiological diagnosis. Anything is sclerotic, avascular necrosis, it will be looking dense on the X-ray. So whenever we will get the child between 5 to 12 years, where the avascular necrosis of capital femoral apophysis happens without any etiology, it's idiopathic in nature, it is a Perthes disease. And second, the most important point for the definition, it is a self-limiting. So the avascular necrosis would be followed by the revascularization. So whenever in a left side, when we see about the avian changes, it will be called as the active Perthes disease. When there is no evidence of the avascular necrosis, it will be called as the healed Perthes disease. Where it is common, there are a lot of epidemiological factors, but it is somehow the unknown reason. It is very common in the southwest coastal plain. And whether we are fortunate or unfortunate, we need to have a lot of the frequency of the Perthes disease. Compared to the Western literature, the Indian literature do have the Perthes disease common in the rural area, compared to the Liverpool, where it is common in the crowded area. And the age of onset in Indian scenario, the children are older than the Western population. Second, the age and sex ratio would be different in Indian, where we do find many girls are also involved compared to the Western literature. How to diagnose Perthes disease? Common symptoms between 5 to 12 years of age, any child on this particular belt complain about pain and limp. You may think about the Perthes disease, very common in boy. The cardinal features, the main sign of the diagnosing Perthes disease is the restriction of the range of motion. And common being is the abduction and internal rotation. It may be mild, it may be moderate, or very rarely we will see about the severe restriction of range of motion. Most commonly, when we find the patient will have the abduction or internal rotation on one side from 5 to 12 years of age from this belt, we can think about the Perthes disease. We need to get it evaluated by the radiograph. The investigation of the choice for this particular patient pathology would be the plain X-ray. The AP radiograph would be the diagnostic. Frog lateral should be taken whenever the range of motion would be adequate. What is the natural history of the Perthes disease? As I said, from the definition itself, the avascular necrosis would be followed by the revascularization. So whenever it is a self-limiting disorder, the avascular necrosis happens, it would be followed by the fragmentation of apophysis, revascularization, and complete healing. So it can be based on the natural history, the evolution of the disease can be classified into the 4 different stages. Stage 1 is avascular necrosis. Second stage would be the stage of fragmentation. where the newborn started from the periphery. It is the state of regeneration, and the fourth stage would be heal stage. And that classification is modified by Dr. Benjamin. It's called as modified Elizabethtown. It originally was the Waldenström classification. So I will show you the what is the different parts of the classification. So in stage one, where is the avascular necrosis? And I said before, that is a density of the femoral head would be more. So whenever the avascular necrosis happen and it will be in a single piece without any fragmentation, it will be stage of avascular necrosis. Further, it can be divided into two. 1A, where the height is maintained, where 1B, the height would be decreased compared to the opposite side. So this is a stage of the avascular necrosis. Whenever we'll see about the fissure running from the subchondral bone to the physis, vertical fissure, not about the horizontal fissure. Many of the postgraduate will get confused about horizontal fissure. That is a separate sign, but that would be considered as a stage of the fragmentation. In case of the early stage of fragmentation, single or two fissure would be present. That would be called as a early stage of the fragmentation. When the fragmentation number increases, that would be called as the stage of the advanced fragmentation. Then comes about the regeneration. The newborn forms from the lateral aspect, that is the density of the bone would not be like the capital femoral epiphysis. The density is little less than the capital femoral epiphysis. It is stage 3A. When the newborn forms more than one third of the capital femoral epiphysis, it will be called as stage of the advanced regeneration. And once it is completed, there is no evidence of the sclerosis. When there is femoral head density looks like exactly like opposite side, that will be called as advanced healing or the stage 4 healing. So this entire process will take around 2 to 4 years in every single patient. So if you divide that, it's that from the left-hand side, the first stage of the avascular necrosis to the stage of fragmentation, then the early reconstitution, then it go for the healed. And that is the basic modified Elizabethtown classification. How does it help? It gives idea about the natural process of the natural history of the Perthes disease. And if we know about that, the most of the deformation or the femoral head changes happens in advanced stage of the fragmentation. So if you want to do any intervention, we need to do in early stage of disease before the head can go for the late fragmentation. So why need to treat this Perthes disease? Because the healing is, it's a self-limiting disorder. The femoral head gets complete revascularization, but in a process of revascularization at the time of advanced fragmentation or early regeneration, femoral head may lose its sphericity. And that can be the coxa magna, that may be coxa breva, or that may be the irregular shape. And the irregular shape can be one of the reason precursor for the secondary osteoarthritis, and we need to prevent that. And that would be the goal of the Perthes disease. Before going for the goal of the Perthes disease, I will address few points, because most of the postgraduate would be asked by the traditional examiner, what do you mean by the different classification of the Perthes disease? In 1970, the widely popular classification in United Kingdom is the Cattrall classification. He divided it into the four, less than half, more up to half, the more than half, or the complete involvement. What is the importance or relevance of this classification? As and when, because the more head is involved, that would be associated with the poor prognosis. Less involved, it would be going with the good prognosis. Unfortunately, this classification can be only applied in the advanced stage of the fragmentation. So it would not be utilized for the decision making. It was used in decision making before, but historically it should not be used nowadays. Second popular classification is a lateral pillar classification. Thoughtfully thought about the classification when the height of the lateral pillar is maintained. That is A, when it is reduced to the 50%, it is type B. And when it is more than 50%, head is collapsed, that is a type C. What is the relevance of this? Again, that will be associated with the prognosis. It can predict about the prognosis. Herring C would be associated with the poor prognosis. But again, unfortunately, we cannot use this classification in early stage of disease. It can be applied only in advanced stage of fragmentation. Third and most important classification would be the Stuhlbarg. Do not get confused with the modified Elizabeth classification, Cattrall and Herring classification, because Stuhlbarg is used for the predicting the outcome of the disease. Evaluate the outcome of disease by the Stuhlbarg 1. It is gone from 1 to 5. 1 is the best and 5 is the worst. What is a 1? After healing at skeletal maturity, if femoral head goes exactly like the opposite side, it will be Stuhlbarg 1. If it is associated with the mild enlargement of femoral head or shortening of neck, it would be Stuhlbarg 2. When the apian frog lateral, if the head looks like an umbrella or egg that is ovoid in nature, that would be a 3. So when apian frog lateral diameter of the head would be different, that is a Stuhlbarg 3. So when there is a, so 1, 2 and 3 are the congruent hip, where 1 and 2 are the spherical congruent, while 3 is aspherical congruent. The fourth one is that there is a flattening of the head, but the acetabulum will also remodel. So it is aspherical congruent is 4. Well, in a 5, that would be, you can see there is an irregularity of the femoral head and acetabulum doesn't remodel. That is a Stuhlbarg 5. So Stuhlbarg 1 would be associated with very good outcome and Stuhlbarg 5 would be associated with the poor outcome. So what we learn that when there is irreversible deformation happens at the time of the fragmentation, so the aim of disease to prevent the deformation of femoral head, maintain the sparsity of the femoral head, and if child present late, we need to correct the alteration in the size and shape of the femoral head. If it is a healed Perthes, we need to treat about the sequelae of the Perthes disease to prevent the pain and prevent the arthritis. So in somebody is going to ask, what is a treatment plan? Aim is to prevent the femoral head deformation, indirectly to prevent the degenerative secondary osteoarthritis. So depends on the stage of the presentation, we can divide into before the advanced stage of fragmentation. If child present early, it will be called as a preventive intervention. If child present after the stage of the advanced fragmentation, it would be remedial surgery, or if it is present beyond the stage 3B, it will be a salvage surgery. Let us see one by one on the preventive aspect. So we are talking at the early stage of disease, stage of avascular necrosis and early fragmentation. There are the 5 important factors that will influence the prognosis of Perthes, that is the age of onset, stage of disease, the extent of epiphyseal involvement, the presence of epiphyseal extrusion and range of motion. Earlier the onset would be associated with good outcome. Late age or the older age would be associated with poor outcome. The extent of involvement, as I said, more than half involvement, it would be associated with poor. Unfortunately, we don't see the patient with less than half involved epiphyses. The presence of epiphyseal extrusion, if it is present, it will be associated with, as the green said, more than 20% would be associated with the deformation of femoral head. Unfortunately, this is the only variable we do have control that has to be reversed. The range of motion, all the range of motion are restricted. We need to do restoration of the range of motion. We should never ever plan the surgery when range of motion is restricted. So how can we decide about decision making? Earlier the onset, younger the patient, we can treat conservatively, and the older patient, it requires the containment even before the extrusion, because natural history shows that those kids will go for the extrusion. Less than half doesn't require containment, more than half will require the containment. Earlier the stage of disease, it would be good, because we have seen the ratio of getting the spherical head is 70 times higher than the late presentation. And range of motion restricted, never ever embark either femoral or the pelvic osteotomy. If the range of motion is restricted, it can be restored by keeping about traction. If you read about the Western textbook, they will be associated with the medial release and medial capsulotomy and adductor release. But it would be costial to give the traction in the Western literature. In Indian scenario, we can treat with the bilateral AK traction. And always reassess the range of motion after a few weeks of traction. If it is not restored, we can take the child under anesthesia and keep the broomsticks cast. Only consider containment after range of motion is restored. What are the containment surgery? It is two containment procedure. One is the femoral osteotomy and second is the pelvic osteotomy. There are advantage. It's easy to perform and it would be very easy when postgraduate can do about the femoral containment. Pelvic osteotomy, that would not be associated with the limp or shortening. There is no verticalization of epiphyseal plate, but unfortunately, there is no article shows the pelvic containment can alter the natural history. Normally, it will require only 20 degree of varus and 20 degree of rotation. Whenever we do the varus, you need to associate it, we have to do the trochanteric epiphyseodesis in order to prevent the limp, permanent limp, because trochanter will go high. Explain that how it is there, the red part is involved. So red part will go on the inside the acetabulum and that is containment. How it has been achieved? Keeping the hip in abducted and internal rotated and you can cut the osteotomy and make it straight. And that is the containment osteotomy. It can be done with the simple blade or blade plate. This is the example of the varus extension osteotomy. In cut short, when the age is more than 7 without extrusion, if it is happening, we can do about the containment surgery when the range of motion is restored. In younger age, if it is extrusion, we can do about the containment surgery between 5 to 7. The few example, 5-year-old boy without any extrusion treated with conservative treatment and at maturity, it's a good outcome. Another child, 6 year, is presented with the early stage, but there is extrusion, 35% of extrusion. So it was treated with the varus derotation osteotomy. And the 5 years later, we can see the spherical congruent hip. The 7.5-year-old child, as it's presents at the early stage of disease with extrusion, we are very aggressive on treating and that, and the skeletal maturity, we can see the spherical congruent hip. Always do the trochanteric epiphyseodesis because we have seen that it will work up to the 10 years of age. And this is the working in the trochanteric epiphyseodesis. I'm not going in detail about controversy about the Perthes disease, but there is no level one study for that. What should we do if child present late in the remedial or the late stage of fragmentation? What are the problem? There is extrusion and the hinge abduction. So it may require the containment, but chances of getting about the spherical head would be very less. So we need to think whether the child has got hinge abduction or not. So what do you mean by hinge abduction? If there is a when we abduct the hip, the center of the femur head and center of the movement happen at the same place. When we have the hinge abduction, the center of the rotation of the hip joint will move on the side and the lateral margin of the acetabulum. So if we see the joint space in abduction, it will be uniform in case of the normal abduction. But if in case of the hinge abduction, it's crescentric widening, it is medial joint space would be more. And that is the hinge abduction. It is easily detected on the plain X-ray, but whenever we are in doubt, it can be associated with the medial arthrogram, medial pooling of dye. And the clinically we can detect by reducing the range of motion. We can say that severe restriction of the range of motion in the later stage of disease. And whenever in doubt, we can see about the medial pooling of dye. What should we treat the hinge abduction? There are multiple treatment options, but once it is post-collapse, I will say that we are not going to get the spherical congruent hip like Stuhlberg 1 in most of the case. If it is not coxa magna, if it is not associated with hinge abduction, it can be treated with the varus derotation osteotomy. If it is there, it can be done with the valgus osteotomy or Chiari osteotomy or the Stelf osteotomy. But beware that Stuhlberg 1 and 2 are not very common. Few points on the salvage surgery because it is fancy and it's new. Sometimes it would be asked for the recent advances in the pediatric orthopedic or Perthes disease. What should we do if it is associated with coxa brevis, magna or irregularis? How does it work? It will increase the stress across the hip. In fact, of the intra-articular or extra-articular impingement, and it can lead to the more stress across the hip. It can lead to the secondary osteoarthritis due to the joint irregularity. So what is the treatment? If it is only isolated coxa brevis, means short neck, it can be treated with the trochanteric advancement, and we can do the distalization and lateralization of trochanter and fixing with this two screw. That was a traditional historical treatment. Recent advances we can do about relative neck lengthening. Take out about trochanter piece, take the central bone and take the distal and lateral advancement of glottal trochanter and fix with two screw. Or if this is an example of the relative neck lengthening, or if it is associated with the shortening, we can do about the third osteotomy below about the inferior aspect of neck and fix with the screw. That is a Mosca's osteotomy. It is an example of the Mosca's osteotomy. What should we do for that? Again, I will urge that this surgery should be reserved whenever we'll get the spherical or the ovoid shape. Should not do for the frankly irregular hip. What should you do for coxa magna and irregularis? It can be dealt with the osteochondroplasty if it is impingement or Grant's head reduction osteotomy. Like this case where there is an osteochondroplasty can be planned because of the femoroacetabular impingement, and we can do with the spherical template at the safe surgical dislocation and do about the distalization of trochanter relative neck lengthening. And Gans osteotomy, we can do about the central part defect, take out about the head reduction osteotomy and fix it with the screws and plates. But we don't know about the future of such surgery. In the long-term result of this surgery is unknown. The conversion of total hip replacement is more than 25%. The salvage option of the for the relief of pain may be femoral head reshaping, hip arthrodesis, or total joint replacement, depends on the patient need. It concludes, pathes is a self-limiting disorder. It's an idiopathic avascular necrosis, common in Southwest. Abduction and internotation is key for the diagnosis. Plain radiography is the diagnostic. We can see about sclerosis and collapse. Prevention of the femoral head deformation is the prime goal. And containment, if you plan, you need to do in early stage of disease. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Hitesh. That was a comprehensive overview of Perthes disease. And I know that a lot of the original academic work in getting to this point of understanding was actually done at Manipal. So Thomas, do we have any questions from?
Yes, somebody wanted to know what is the duration of traction applied?
Duration of traction, it should be for the 7 days to 10 days. If the spasm doesn't relieve that, it can be treated with the broomstick cast. If we apply a traction, bilateral ICA traction, 90% of patient will regain the range of motion.
And the other question was, what was the end point of traction? When will you decide that, what movements do you actually look for when you decide that this much of traction is enough? Is it abduction, internal rotation?
Yeah. The most probably, if we are going to plan for the surgical intervention by varus derotation osteotomy, at least 30 degree of abduction would be required. And if you want to do about derotation, minimum about 20 degree of the internal rotation would be required, because that will get compromised after the surgery if we are not getting. So if we are getting about the full abduction, we can, and not internal rotation, we can do about the varus extension osteotomy rather than varus derotation osteotomy.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
Yes. Sorry, was there another question? Sorry, there's one last question, Dr. Hitesh.
Yeah.
And that was, the ones who are being treated non-operatively, are they on protected weight bearing?
Yes, that is one of the controversial questions. We do protect them up to the stage of the advanced regeneration, but the Western world doesn't follow that. We are planning, we are involved in the study to get that, to get the correct answer. But yes, we do follow that non-weight bearing. So that point I have not addressed, but I strongly believe in non-weight bearing, and Harry Kim has shown a very good result with the non-weight bearing. Okay, that's a controversial question, but the answer is still unknown, but I do believe.
So thank you. Those are the questions that we got. Sorry, that's all I have.
By non-weight bearing, do you mean strict non-weight bearing with crutches or protected, you know, some kind of restriction of activity or strict non-weight bearing?
We do follow with the bilateral axillary crutch with non-weight bearing. We train them actually. So we continue about the maintaining the range of motion only the weight bearing would be avoided. So we allow the seating and every activity, not sports activity, but non-weight bearing.
Stages 1 and 2 or throughout the course of the disease?
Yes, throughout the course of disease, for up to the stage of the advanced region, stage 3B.
So up to stage 3B. Okay. Thank you.
Sorry, one more question. Somebody has asked for head-in-head phenomenon.
Head-in-head phenomena, it is seen in the, it's described in the cattle when it is started with that, the head-in-head phenomena, where it's a regeneration happens from the periphery and center part is the sclerotic. That would be called as the head-in-head phenomena.
Okay. And one more clinical head-at-risk signs.
A clinical head-at-risk sign, it is one of the favorite of the old examiner, but I will urge that it is only given in the cattle textbook chapter in Oxford textbook. Other than that, nobody has mentioned, it is never published before, but you want to quote that it is given in the Oxford textbook written by the Cattrall. When the range of motion is severely restricted, he said about head at risk sign clinical, but please don't mention that because many people will challenge that.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Hitesh Shah. Thank you.
Hitesh, I have a question. Sometimes we see this late parthis, you know, children who are more than 8 years, 9 years presenting with this. So does the same rule applicable or how do you manage them? What's your advice? Late presentations. Can you hear me? Some problem.
No, we can hear you.
We can hear you. We can hear you.
Hitesh, I think he's not able to connect.
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yeah, yes. Now we can hear you.
Yeah, can you hear me? At the older age group between 7 to 12 years, the natural history we see, they are invariably going to have the extrusion in stage of fragmentation. So we treat them very early in the stage of disease. If they present before the stage of advanced fragmentation, in early fragmentation, we do the same. Same protocol till the adolescent age group.
Thank you.
So next, Dr. Prasad will be speaking about septic arthritis.
Thank you, Jayant. Thanks for Bone School. Thanks to Dr. Thomas Kishan for organizing this. This was way back, I think maybe 4 or 5 years back I had attended. It's very nice to see the restart.
All of the illustrations are by Dr. Rudra Prasad. He's also a very accomplished artist.
I have not put many of my arts here, but anyway, thank you. So I come from Indira Gandhi Institute of Child Health. Those of you don't know about me, but anyway, this is an institute which is in Bangalore. It's a tertiary government organization, which is autonomous and situated in South Bangalore. Today, I'll be discussing about septic arthritis of the hip joint with special interest in neonatal septic arthritis, because the topic is quite big, because the sequelae of infection itself is a big topic, like classification of the post septic sequelae, management, everything will be a big topic. So I am going to stress upon the importance of diagnosis, management, and how we manage at our institute about the septic arthritis, especially in the neonates and newborns. So do we need to discuss this separately? Yes, this is definitely different from the way it is in adults or even in adolescent children. It's a very different approach altogether when we start managing them, because they have very bad consequences, because these are very young skeleton when they get infected. And if you're not understanding properly when to intervene and about the management, the results are very bad. And these consequences are for life, not for short time. So this can be a very bad consequence where both the femoral head are affected. This we do see. It's not a surprise. We do see in a government hospital like ours. And, you know, this stage, probably only the salvage procedures we can offer. Very important to identify them. For that, it's very important as early as possible, we need to recognize that. For that, high index of suspicion should be there whenever there is a presentation of something like that. So So what it can lead to if you don't recognize them, these four Ds: destruction of the articular cartilage, epiphyseal cartilage, damage to the growth plate near the joint, and the joint can get dislocated with the damage to the blood supply. So it's important to understand that most of these infections are hematogenous. They are not because of any local infection. Quite commonly, these newborns or infants, they get infected because of the hematogenous spread. Sequelae can be very disastrous. And commonly, the bacterial infections are the one which are predominant. So why we started seeing a lot of septic arthritis? Because of the recognition, because we are able to diagnose them. And of course, the NICU cares are improved nowadays, and more babies are surviving, those who became very bad because of some other infection. And they get, obviously, they are more prone for joint infections. Suppose there is a peritonitis, there is a meningitis, or some other urinary tract infection, pneumonia. So these babies are prone for joint infection as well. So there's a terminology, NICU graduates. Now, in fact, we sometimes use, when we see these children, grown-up children coming to us with a surprising changes of the femoral head, which are damaged, then when we take a history, they always say that there was admission in the NICU for some purpose. So even though they did not had any joint presentation at that time, because it was not recognized or whatever, and this because of the consequences, they present to us late. So when we go ahead with the literature, this is common things are, you know, the same things that MRSA, bad infection, permanent skeletal deformities, and early detection gives the better results. These are the common, message what we get. There won't be any deaths, but there is a severe joint destruction. So the ultimate thing is early diagnosis, appropriate management with proper antibiotics, and most of the time it's a surgical drainage, which minimizes the morbidity. So we need to remember some of the things that these under the age of 5 years, they are very more susceptible. Neonates, they need to be identified only with the index of suspicion, and pseudo paralysis is one of the thing which is presented quite well. And quite often they are picked up by the neonatologist or the pediatrician, because these kids are not seen by the orthopedic surgeon directly. And of course, the presence of other organ sepsis should make one suspect joint infection. Nowadays, in a hospital like tertiary care, most of the people are aware, and where there is a department of orthopedics. So people keep seeing for the joint, they keep examining the joints. Even a slightest suspicion, they call the specialist. So what are the organisms? You know, most of you know that commonly the staph aureus is one thing which is very common. But in neonates and newborn, I must tell, the gram-negative sepsis is more common. That's because of various reasons, because a hospital where I work is a tertiary care referral hospital. We get referral from the different government sector again. So where there is a hygienic problems, contaminations, handling of the babies, and coexistent sepsis, and mother having a urinary tract infection. So these are the reasons why they can have gram-negative sepsis. And MRSA is on the rise, methicillin resistant staph aureus is on the rise for sure. So what are the risk factors in neonatal septic arthritis? So one most important is the prematurity. Relatively, they are immunocompromised, so they are very more prone for this. Caesarean section, again, we don't know the exact reason why section babies have the high incidence of neonatal sepsis, but maybe the handling and, you know, the instrument, other things may come into the picture. And as I said about the NICU, it is the same thing, where the babies are managed with umbilical catheterization and some other invasive procedures in the babies. So they are more prone. There are some poor prognostic factors. So age less than 6 months, because of the not recognized early, not recognized in time. Most of the time it is, there is some delay in the presentation. And more than 4 days until presentation. So it is so important to identify them within 1 or 2 days. If you can identify them, most of the morbidity can be reduced. And hip joint has got more, it itself is a joint involvement of the hip itself is a poor prognostic factor, because hip is one thing which can be missed, especially in an immunocompromised baby, premature, not having any clinical symptoms. and you know, this can be missed. This is just a statistics between 2017 to 18. Out of 122 neonates admitted for suspected sepsis in the joints, you can imagine the hip is taking the maximum numbers. So because it can be missed very easily. So septic arthritis in infancy is truly alarming situation. There are some anatomical factors why they have a very bad involvement in the area, because the most of the vessels, they penetrate the fascial. So if there is an involvement in the bone, there can be involvement in the joint. So, or vice versa. So there can be a growth plate which gets irreversibly damaged. So what are the questions when we see these septic arthritis in neonates and newborns? So about the diagnosis. And then antibiotic policy. Do we have a policy or do we have any protocol? And then surgical intervention. When do we operate? And then what are the approaches which are used? So I'll be touching on these points in my next slides. So diagnosis is, as I keep telling, it is a suspicion. So one has to have a suspicion. Okay, there is some reduced movement. Probably there is a sepsis. Very, very common. If a baby or a neonate is not moving unless otherwise proved, we take it as a septic arthritis of the hip joint. Because knee joint is revealed, ankle is revealed, or any other area is revealed, but the hip is concealed. So we can miss the diagnosis. So of course the presentation varies from neonate and a child. You know, in a child, especially a walking child, will have some complaints, stops walking, or complaints of pain. In a neonate, all these things are absent. So investigations commonly done is complete blood count, ESR, CRP, and blood culture. All these babies are commonly, you know, asked for these reports. So X-ray is important to identify if there is any gross destruction of the proximal femur, something like involvement of the proximal osteomyelitis of the femur, along with dislocation or separation, whatever. This is X-ray is a must. And ultrasound scan is very commonly used and very repeatedly asked investigation in our practice. Ultrasound scan, because if you all can understand this, young cartilage in the proximal femur is not seen in the X-ray. So only thing what we see is the bones. So when we ask for an ultrasound scan can clearly tell, in fact, a good radiologist can tell whether there is a exudate or a transudate or whatever, the consistency of the collection inside the joint volume, even the morphology of the femoral cartilage head also can be revealed by ultrasound scan. MRI, we don't ask, it is not really required in the routine way. MRI is only in case of doubts, in case of involvement in the bone, or any other soft tissue involvement or pathology we maybe is required. So there are criterias for the diagnosis, especially this is applicable in a walking child, but of course they can be used to certain age. So the non-weight bearing on the affected side, about 3% likelihood of septic arthritis. So you keep giving the score, a score of 4, obviously, has got more chances. A child is not able to take the load on that. And then ESR is very high, fever, and then white blood cell. Among all these things, the white blood cell count, which is more than 12,000, is more specific for diagnosis. So clinically, these neonates are quite irritable, failure to thrive. They don't take feeds, and there's lack of movement in this particular joint. And there can be erythema and swelling in certain situations. So what do we do? How do we manage them? So certainly, if they are not in the hospital, they need to be admitted. So you admit them in the ICU where there is a care by the pediatrician. So it's always a multidisciplinary. I know that certain hospitals have got no pediatric ICU or a neonatal ICU. Probably they certainly it's wise to take such help. Or if there is any facility like that available to send them. IV antibiotics are started and aspiration followed by arthrotomy is taken into decision. So what are the IV antibiotics? Of course, it is depending on the antibiotic policy of the particular hospital and department. So it varies from hospital to hospital and what kind of a routine organism we are seeing in our practice. All these things we have to take into consideration. So before I go to the surgical aspects, I just want to tell about a few aspects about blood supply. I think this topic is important in many aspects of the hip discussion, whether it is as SCIFI, Perthes, or septic arthritis, everything, this vascular anatomy is important. And the picture on the left side is what most of the textbook or whatever online anatomical description is given. But after the GANS safe surgical dislocation popularity, and there is a better understanding of the anatomy of the vascularity, it is derived from the medial circumflex artery, which runs from the posterior and goes on the posterior intertrochanteric groove. And then it enters this area superior posteriorly is where it gives three branches, and these three branches gives the most of the blood supply to the proximal femur. Why I'm telling here, it's very important to know this so that in the surgical drainage, never to attempt any drainage posteriorly. It's an important message, because if you are doing the drainage either laterally or posteriorly, especially in the area where I said, certainly it lands up in avascular necrosis. So these are some of the pictures of the approaches. So this is the anterior approach, classically what we use for the Smith-Peterson approach, and the lateral. So the vessel, what I was telling, it's somewhere here. So one needs to be very careful. The incisions are anteriorly, which is just below the, about 2 centimeter below. So in a newborn, there is hardly any space from the iliac crest. So it's just a 1 finger breadth below, we take a linear incision. The incision need not be very long. You can just take a small incision of 2 to 2.5 centimeter, and then identify the interval between the sartorius and tensor fasciae lata. And then the next structure, what you get is the rectus femoris. So then we need to retract that medially, and then you see pericapsular fat, and then you incise. And we always make sure that we take out a segment of the capsule so that the capsule doesn't get closed. These newborns or whatever children, when we are operating, this capsule can get closed and the infection can continue. So what do we do? We, as I said, in our hospital, we use ceftriaxone and amikacin because that's the supply of the hospital. But otherwise, you have to use whatever antibiotic policy you have in your hospital. We admit them in NICU, and then we investigate with the blood, ultrasound scan, and X-ray, as I discussed. And of course, we take them immediately. If there is a suspicion, if the ultrasound scan is proving, if the blood counts are altered, we always take them to OT. Even arthrocentesis, that is aspiration, is also done under anesthesia. So this is a baby with a bilateral septic arthritis. Very rare to see, but no surprise, sometimes we can see that. And these kind of collection, which is yellowish, turbid, may not be all the time what we get it. It may be a simple transurate. But still, if the symptomatic child is there, I think that has to be treated like a septic arthritis. So then, of course, it is followed by a small incision, as I showed in the picture, anterior arthrotomy, plane between the two muscles, and then successfully we can drain the collection. So the intravenous antibiotics are administered till the clinical improvement. That's the protocol. So how long the antibiotic should be given, I'll come to that later. It is most of the time the clinical improvement is what is taken into consideration. We usually ask the mother or the parents who are attending the child, how is the pain in terms of comforts of the child? So if they say that they are better, probably that's when we stop. And of course, other things which are taken into consideration is the ESR and CRP. In the follow-up period, when the blood counts are asked, every week we keep asking for the blood counts. And every fifth day, the ultrasound scan is done, so that the post-operative follow-up is very, very useful with the ultrasound scan, blood investigations, and clinical assessment. All these three things are taken into consideration. And then if there is an improvement, then the antibiotics, IV, intravenous antibiotics, are stopped and then converted into oral for another 1 to 2 weeks, depending on the requirements. So another way of managing them is arthroscopy. Now many people are into arthroscopy. So you can just do arthroscopy. Even people who are doing arthroscopy, the septic arthritis needs some experience. This is how that looks completely with the synovial hypertrophy and predominance. Nothing can be seen. So one needs a little bit of experience to do this, especially doing on small babies, really requires a lot of expertise because the cartilage damage and all these things are there. Shigella kingae is a rare organism, and some of the people have reported this. They're usually associated with the osteomyelitis also. Very rare sites like sternum, clavicle, calcaneum, these are the areas along with septic arthritis may be there. So in terms of post-operative follow-up, we always do CRP and erythrocyte sedimentation rate. ESR and CRP are very important. And more out of these two, CRP gives a better sensitivity pattern because it continues to be elevated, unlike ESR, which is gets normalized or comes down by 24 days. See, some of the picture, this is our own statistics. Of course, these statistics can vary from hospital to hospital, but you must remember that the most commonest organism is the gram positive and then the gram negative in terms of neonates or small children. Gram negative sepsis is more common. And majority of them, this is the common scenario, especially in our country. There may not be any growth because all these kids, especially children who are walking, they would have got treated by other pediatricians or orthopedic surgeons or anybody with IV antibiotics. So unless otherwise, these things are proved, it's always a surgical management. There is never a conservative management for septic arthritis in the hip joint. If the hip is proved to be a septic arthritis, it's always surgical management. So what do we do in our, this is what the protocol we have drawn. There is a symptoms of paucity of limb movements, pain, swelling, fever, hyperthermia, reduced feeds of the infants, then associated with the clinical findings. Then we go ahead with the ultrasound scan, X-ray, MRI if required. Then the lab investigations are added. So this is how it is done. So then we start them on a empirical antibiotics till the culture is arrived. Culture reports are arrived in 2 to 3 days. Then you can select definitive antibiotics. And fungal infection to be suspected whenever there is a lymphocytosis. Most of the time it is a neutrophilia. So if there is any lymphocytosis, fungal infection have to be kept in mind. And then of course it is followed with arthrocentesis or arthrotomy most of the time. And then changing the antibiotic as per culture, you can take a call. And then of course every fifth day, we do a repeat ultrasound scan and the other blood parameters. So this is how it is on the fifth day. Then if there is an improvement, probably we can continue to change them on oral antibiotic. If there is no improvement, then probably a repeat arthrotomy, because this whatever arthrotomy incision we would have made, it would have got closed. So that may require a repeat arthrotomy. And then of course, once the clinical improvement along with the biochemical parameters are becoming normal, then we discharge them on oral antibiotics with a weekly follow-up up to 3 weeks. So this is what is the protocol. So the message is very clear. The antibiotic need not be continued for a very long time as the thought before. They're usually given for 1 to 2 weeks maximum and then followed by oral antibiotics for weekly interval, maybe 2 to 3 weeks. So there are enough of studies to support this, whatever I'm telling. The short-term treatment is quite sufficient. So as I said, it is always a multidisciplinary approach. It's not that only orthopedic department is managing. It has to be managed with the other subspecialties like microbiology, pediatrician, neonatologist, etc. Sometimes the isolating organism may be difficult. So you may have to discuss with the microbiologist for an extended culture. There are things like extended culture and PCR amplification. Some of the techniques, if they are available in any particular hospital, you can take that help. Some of the pictures I'll be showing, as I was telling you, for the especially the PGs, who don't see frequently this X-rays of a newborn, the cartilage is not seen at all, only the proximal femur is seen. So this case, if you carefully observe, it is actually dislocated. The hip is actually dislocated or subluxated. And you have to see the Shenton's line and some of the classical lines like Hilgen-Rienes and Perkins lines, one has to draw and confirm. And of course, if there is a doubt, we have to ask for an ultrasound scan. This is the same X-ray, same child's X-ray, you can see that there was an involvement. These X-rays are taken in the follow-up period where you can see a lot of bone formation in the proximal, which is suggestive that the septic arthritis was also associated, with the osteomyelitis. This is a common scenario, especially if they come late and if there is any MRSA organism involvement. So some of the other X-rays, what should not happen, especially in children when they come late, very late, this is how they present. They come with a dislocation, very bad infection, and you can see them some changes in the proximal femur as well. So what happens to them? just to tell you, the ESR was 87, 45 was the CRP, and 16,000 was the total count, and arthrotomy was done. And of course, the implants fixation is not generally recommended, but because this was so unstable, we had to go with a temporary KVAR fixation, and they were removed after 2 to 3 days. So this is a bad scenario. This should not happen. So early diagnosis is what is important. Later, they land up in very bad hip joints beyond any preservation. To conclude my talk, so here I'm not touching on the late sequelae of the septic arthritis because there are so many things. So I thought I'll give importance to the message that about the antibiotic policy and then arthrotomy and diagnosis. So the conclusion is high index of suspicion is very important to have an early diagnosis and antibiotics to be rightly selected. And it's most of the time always early surgical intervention and to follow with the short-term parenteral antibiotics, and you have to protect against the late sequelae. So it's a surgical emergency. That's what is the message. Thank you.
That's great. Fantastic talk, Rudra, and just wealth of clinical cases and material that you have at Indira Gandhi Hospital. 155 cases of septic arthritis in 2 years is just, I don't think many other institutions can match those sorts of numbers. We want to see those numbers coming down with better NICU management, but at least we should try and save these hips at the earliest opportunity. Thomas, questions?
Yes, I think a couple of questions. One was Dr. Rudra Prasad, how much of an emergency is this? Is this something for which you have to go wake up in the night and go and do it? Or is it something that can be put on the next day's list?
Certainly, it is not that emergency that you have to wake up at night and go and do it. Because these are cases where you have an ultrasound scan and all these things. Obviously, these things are not done in the night. It's only the X-ray or some facilities like that. So you need to have a proper, of course, the preparation is very important. We have to establish the diagnosis. That's most important. So you can definitely plan and do it in the morning, you know?
Yeah. The other question is, would you start antibiotics before the arthrotomy or only after the arthrotomy?
No, as I said, empirically, the antibiotic policy, whatever the hospital policy has, based on the organisms detected in the past, whatever cases. So every hospital will have a policy. Based on that, you can empirically start on them. You don't have to wait till the culture comes, because culture comes quite late. So most of the time, again, the age of the baby or age of the child is taken into consideration. If you are dealing with a neonate, most probably it is a gram-negative sepsis, as I discussed. If it is a little bit bigger child, maybe walking child, then gram-positive comes into picture. So these are taken into consideration. Based on that, you can start whether you want to cover the positive organisms or the negative organisms.
Okay. Thank you. One more question. I think this is a long one. It says, age-wise difference in management of septic arthritis between neonates, infants, and two-year-olds. Two and five-year-olds.
Yeah. See, these newborns, neonates, and they're all treated in the similar way. In fact, when the neonates, the problem is, neonates are nothing but the first 28 days of the life. So the problem is identification of itself is a problem. So quite often, even a pediatrician can miss it, because unless, especially if they are concentrating very bad pneumonia of that particular baby, you know, the concentration on the hip joint may go off. So the identification is important. If they are referred with the index of suspicion, probably we can take whatever I discussed. And sure. Children who are walking age, more than 1 year, they have to be treated. Again, these things, as I said, surgical emergency, in terms of the message is very clear that they don't yield to IV antibiotics alone. That is a message. And if you keep waiting, because I have seen some of them, especially pediatricians, waiting for 1 day, 2 day, waiting that, you know, this IV antibiotic, let them act, we'll see. So hip joint being, having so many anatomical factors, you know, they don't do well. Either they go to a vascular problem or a dislocation or some other sequences. So they have to be treated surgically, whether it is a newborn or a walking child, you know, any age. And then these newborns, one special consideration is, you know, if they, especially if they're coming with a subluxated joint, probably postoperatively, they may require a Pavlik harness or a hip spiker to just to stabilize the joint. And in a walking child, they may require a skin traction for a few days. That's the only difference. Otherwise, IV antibiotic, surgical approach, everything remains the same.
Thank you very much, Dr. Rudraprasad. Thank you. Those are the questions that came up. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Rudra. So next, I'd like to invite Dr. Manda Agashe to talk to us about slip capsule femoral epiphyseal. Manda.
Can you see my slides?
Yes,
we can see.
Yeah. All right. Thank you so much, Dr. Jayant Sampath, sir, and Dr. Thomas. It is a great honor for me to talk in the Bone School and with all the stalwarts of pediatric hip with me. So I'm going to talk to you today about something which is very close to my heart, which is slip capital femoral epiphysis. So what exactly is slip capital femoral epiphysis? We know that it's an adolescent hip disorder where there is varus and posterior slippage of the capital femoral epiphysis. Now, to be frank, slip capital femoral epiphysis or SCFE is something of a misnomer because usually the epiphysis remains more or less at the same place, but the metaphysis goes anteriorly and superiorly. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through 10 points of the management of slip capital femoral epiphysis. And the first one is the most important, which is you have to diagnose it well. Why is it so important in SCFE? Because missed diagnosis is extremely common. The commonest scenario is an adolescent who is slightly overweight and comes with distal thigh and knee pain. And there are number of x-rays and MRIs and all those stuff done of the knee. But what is missed is getting an x-ray of the hip. So you can see that upstairs you have a slip capital femoral epiphysis and that is missed. In fact, slip capital femoral epiphysis is one of the commonest missed diagnoses in orthopedic litigations. Once you diagnose, you also have to diagnose the associated conditions. Now, associated conditions in this case are Down syndrome, hypothyroidism, Cushing syndrome, lupus, hypovitaminosis D is extremely common. So you have to get these checked before you embark on any surgical procedure. You have to get an endocrinologist usually involved in order to rule out these issues. We know what is the classification of slip capital femoral epiphysis. Now there are three very important classifications, each with their own importance. The first one is what is known as the temporal classification. In temporal classification, it is basically a timing of the slip. Pre-slip is just a widening or irregularity of the physis. There is no definite time for this. But what is very important is to diagnose it, whether it is acute, chronic, or acute on chronic. Now, an acute slip is a slip which occurs with a history of less than 3 weeks. A chronic slip has a history of chronic hip pain of more than 3 weeks. While an acute on chronic hip is something which is very common, where the child has hip pain since a long, long time, more than 3 weeks, and suddenly falls down, has a small trip in the bathroom, and comes with an acute severe pain. So it's an acute on chronic slip. But the problem with this classification is that it does not predict the risk of AVN. What does predict the risk of AVN is this functional classification or the stability classification, which was described by Randall Loader way back in 1993. He divided slips into two types. One is stable slip, which is ability to bear weight, and unstable slips, unable to bear weight or able to bear weight with severe antalgia. Why is this important? Because stable slips have a very less risk of AVN, less than only about 1 to 2%. While unstable slips have an extremely high rate of AVN, almost 10 to 60%, and in some series, even more than that. We should know what is the severity classification, which is described by Southwick. which is mild, moderate, and severe. Mild is less than 30% of slippage. Moderate is 30 to 50% of slippage, and severe is more than 50% of slippage. We should understand what is slipped capital femoral epiphysis. What is very important to know is that slipped capital femoral epiphysis is different than a traumatic Delbay type 1 fracture. A traumatic Delbay type 1 fracture has a severe slippage, but there are no secondary changes in the metaphysis and the epiphysis. In this case, it's a slow type 1 Salter-Harris injury, which is going through the proliferative and the hypertrophic zones of the physis. Here, the anterior periosteum is slowly stripped and the epiphysis goes medial, posteromedially, and there is severe rounding of the metaphysis. This proximal femoral metaphysis then starts impinging against the acetabulum, which causes cartilage and labral damage. And this has severely high risk of femoroacetabular impingement and further degenerative joint disease. Once you do that, we have to plan. Once to plan, we should know what are the case scenarios of slipped capital femoral epiphysis. So we'll go to two classic case scenarios in SCFE. One is a 15-year-old male, has left hip pain since 3 months, with no history of significant trauma, and has mild pain and restriction of spotting. So you have a 15-year-old adolescent, slightly obese boy, who doesn't have any other problems in activities of daily living, and has come with mild hip pain with mild restriction of squatting, and is able to sit cross-legged. So for all practical purposes, he's otherwise a normal child. And you can see that the left side is moving in an outward manner. So this is a typical out-toeing gait. You can see that the foot progression angle in this case is almost 45 degrees. So this is a classic presentation of slipped capital femoral epiphysis, which is mild, which is out-toeing gait. So any obese adolescent with out-toeing gait, you have to look at the hip and have to rule out an SCFE. Second is the child has an external rotation deformity. Usually in early slips, it's a mild external rotation deformity. And the child has a positive Dremel's sign. This is classic of SCFE, where the ipsilateral knee goes towards the ipsilateral shoulder. So this is because of the obligatory external rotation of that side. On X-rays, you can see one thing which you all many a time see is severe rarefaction and osteopenia, which is typically seen in hypovitaminosis D. And you can see the classic Klein's line sign. Now, this is one line which is very important. You should draw a line on the superior border of the femoral neck. It should pass through at least some part of the epiphysis. This is a normal side. You can see that it is passing through some superior part of the epiphysis. As against that, in this case, you can see that the entire epiphysis is slipped down, and that is why the Klein's line is not intersecting any part of the epiphysis, and thus Klein's line sign is positive. The Southwick's angle is about 30 degrees, so it's about 20-25 degrees of slippage. So this is a chronic, stable, mild slip. So you know you have to classify them, and we have to treat a chronic, stable, mild slip. I'll come to the treatment later on. So we should know, why do these X-ray findings lead to such great and clinical findings? So you have the proximal femur here, and if there is anything which is extremely important in the proximal femur, it is this blood supply, which goes from the posterior aspect, as Dr. Rudra Prasad said, goes to the proximal femoral capital epiphysis. So whatever the treatment is done, we have to protect this blood supply. In slip, what happens is that the proximal femoral metaphysis goes anteriorly, the epiphysis goes slightly posteriorly, which is a chronic process with a lot of callus here. That leads to decrease in the internal rotation of the hip, and that leads to out-toeing of gait. So what happens when this similar hip pathology progresses further? What if happens when the SCFE progresses further? You have another child, is a slightly younger boy, a 12-year-old boy, with left hip pain since 6 months, while right has pain since 3 months. He has gait abnormality, which is increasing over time, and now he is unable to squat and has difficulty in sitting cross-legged. Now, this is a very important finding. He has difficulty in normal activities of daily living. And you have this side. You can see that he has significant amount of Trendelenburg gait, significant waddling, and his external rotation is almost 60 degrees on both sides. The other thing which you look at when you see him walking from the side is that he's not flexing his hip much at all. It's almost like a robotic gait where he is moving almost only about 20 to 30 degrees of the hip and not like the usual way the child should walk. So this is an out-toeing gait with a Trendelenburg gait. And you have the clinical finding of a severe external rotation deformity. On the left, it is almost 40 degrees and on the right, it is 20 degrees. And what is very important is that flexion is restricted to only about 20 degrees on this side. The right side has a flexion of about 90 degrees, which is a slightly lesser involved hip. So the important thing is this. You can see this X-ray, he has a bilateral SCFE. The right side has a slip which is lesser, which is about 30 degrees to 20 degrees. The left side has a severe slippage. You can see that the slip is almost completely toppled down. So we should ask ourselves that why do these X-ray findings lead to such gait and clinical findings? So again, we come back to the same picture. The slip goes ahead. And here there are multiple phases of acuity where the slip goes ahead, ahead and ahead. And then there is a lot of callus which is formed. As you can see here, the posterior vasculature becomes completely tightened here. There's a lot of callus which is sitting on the posterior vasculature, and this leads to severe external rotation. This then starts getting organized and leads to a severe deformity like this, and which when articulating with the acetabulum leads to severe impingement of flexion, leading to severe femoroacetabular impingement here. This causes restricted flexion. What causes the Trendelenburg gait? There is always some amount of proximal femoral overriding or the greater trochanteric overriding, which leads to shortening of the abductors, which leads to this Trendelenburg gait. Thus, this is the finding of a chronic, stable, severe slip. An unstable slip, as we know, the child is unable to bear weight, so we cannot have a gait video of an unstable slip. So how do we treat an SCFE? What are the options? For that, we should know what are the goals of treatment. The first and foremost goal of treatment should be to prevent further slip progression. Once we do that, once we know this goal, that we should not allow the slip to progress further. The second is, if possible, restore proximal femoral anatomy. Along with that, we should see to it that we should not cause AVN, so prevent the complications of AVN, and also prevent femoroacetabular impingement and degenerative joint disease. So these are the various options. We have in-situ pinning, closed reduction, open reduction, safe surgical dislocation. We'll go to them one by one. So what exactly is in-situ pinning? In-situ pinning is exactly what the word means. That is, irrespective of the deformity or irrespective of the severity of the disease, you have to pin it in that position itself. This becomes extremely difficult in a severe slip or even a moderate slip. Because if one has to go perfectly perpendicular to the slip, then it has to be a very anterior entry point, which becomes very difficult. The drill slips, start slipping. And if you go too anteriorly, there are the neurovascular bundles right here. There's a different technique where you can put an oblique screw, which was described by Dr. Prasad Gavrineni, where you can enter through the anterolateral cortex. You may not be absolutely central in the femoral neck, and you may not be absolutely perpendicular to the physis. That also can give rise to good results. This is in situ pinning. A clinical example where you can see it's a mild slip and it has been pinned in situ, and this usually leads to good results. It is a gold standard for mild to moderate slips. It is a percutaneous technique which has very less operative time and blood loss, and it prevents further slip from formation. From progressing. So that is the most important thing. Prevent further slip progression. This is one of the landmark articles. The Iowa group had put forth this. It's a long-term study, almost 35 years of follow-up. You could see that this was the X-ray which they had put as a long-term good result. This is a 38-year follow-up. You can see they had shown it as a good result, but you can still see that there is significant amount of CAM impingement in this X-ray. Do we put a single screw or a double screw? Well, a single well-placed 6.5 mm or a 7 mm screw without washer is enough for stable slips. Two screws may be necessary for unstable slips. However, biomechanically, both of them have been proved to be equivalent. Is there any role for contralateral pinning? The indications for contralateral pinning are these specific indications. One is if the child has endocrinological abnormalities. Second, if the child is very obese, the Western standard is about 35, probably India, the BMI should be lesser, about 30 to 35. If the child has more than 2 years of growth left. So if you have a very young child, we should know that till the time he reaches skeletal maturity, he may have a higher chance of slippage of the other side. And lastly, unreliable follow-up. If the child is going to go away and he may not come back, it is better to pin the other side so that you are safer. Is there any role of closed reduction? So this was the photo in one of Monsetti's papers. Usually most people don't utilize it. There are some Japanese papers who do utilize it. I do not have any experience about it. However, what is very important to know, is there any role for an acute closed reduction? Whether it is gentle, incidental, serendipitous, usually this should not be done, because usually we are never gentle. We are always a bit forceful. And that leads to severe impairment of the posterior blood supply, and that can cause AVN. Is there a role of acute reduction and pinning? What does that mean? There's a very elegant method which was described by this man who was known as Parsh, where you do a Watson-Jones approach and do an open reduction. But here, you just pass a periosteum so that the slip is reduced to a level which is prior to the acute episode. So what does that mean? You have this slip, and it is a chronic slip which is there. So this is the child who is having hip pain since many days. Then suddenly he slips and then comes with an acute on chronic slip. In the Parsh method, you do a mini open capsulotomy. You put a periosteum anteriorly and you reduce it to the level of chronicity. You should not attempt 100% reduction. You should make probably a grade 2 slip into a grade 1 slip and then fix it with a screw. An example of an acute on chronic slip, you can see that there is a significant amount of posteromedial callus, which has been fixed with some amount of reduction. So it's a partial reduction with screw fixation. One of the other methods is an in situ pinning with an anterior burring with anterior osteochondroplasty. This decreases the amount of FAI which is possible. The jury is still out for this. We still don't know the exact efficacy of this method. Next, we come to more complex methods. So here, we want to restore the proximal femoral anatomy. How do we do that? We go anteriorly. This is an anterior approach where you do a cuneiform osteotomy of the metaphysis. You remove as much as callus from the anterior aspect as possible. You cannot go to the posteromedial side. This leads to a significant amount of femoral neck shortening. You shorten the femoral neck and fix it with a screw. What is this approach? This is the cuneiform osteotomy or the original Dunn osteotomy, which was described way back in the 1960s. In the earlier papers, this method had shown excellent results. However, in most other series, there is a very high, almost a 30 to 40% chance of avascular necrosis, and this could not be replicated by others. So what is the new treatment for severe SCFE, which is this, which was started with this great article, The Surgical Dislocation of the Adult Hip, followed by this article by Zibarth and Gans, where they combined the efficacy of the safe surgical dislocation approach with the Dunn's subcapital realignment. So what does that mean? It's basically a Dunn osteotomy, which is performed through the safe surgical dislocation approach. It allows the restoration of the proximal femoral anatomy and prevents further slippage with the help of two things. One is an extensile retinacular flap, and second is the subperiosteal exposure of the femur for reduction and fixation. I'm just going to go briefly with that. What does that mean? You have a severe slip. You do something which is known as a trochanteric osteotomy. So it's a digastric osteotomy. You flip the trochanter anteriorly. You dislocate the femur anteriorly. So the entire proximal femur is out anteriorly. you release the entire proximal femoral blood supply. The retinacular flap is created so that this blood supply is completely intact by keeping this intact. You can remove the entire callus like this, reduce it well, fix it one with one screw and two K wires or with two screws, relocate the hip back and fix the trochanter. I'm just going to go through few case clinical pictures. You can see that this is the lateral approach which is used. This is the digastric flap. This is the greater trochanter. This is the vastus lateralis and the gluteus medius. So it has two bellies to this flap. So this is a digastric flap. The anterior capsulotomy is performed, and you can see that the entire proximal femur, the femoral head, is dislocated anteriorly. So this is the main problem area. You have a severe bump, and this is where what we should completely release. You can see that there is a big retinacular flap starting right here, going right down, and the osteotomy is marked right here. After which you can safely relocate the femoral head. You can see that the entire retinacular flap is completely intact and the proximal femur is subperiosteally released. All the while, you should see to it that the blood supply of the proximal femur is completely intact. You can see that it is bleeding, and that is the test that it is a vascular head that which you have left with. This is the postoperative X-ray of the same child with bilateral slip. This side has been fixed in situ, and this side has been fixed with safe surgical dislocation with a trochanteric osteotomy. You can see that the trochanter is distalized and fixed with two screws. This is 1 year follow-up. You can see that it has excellently healed. There is no AVN, and he has almost full range of motion. However, we should know that it should be reserved usually for unstable slips, especially in the first few cases. It is an extremely technically demanding procedure, and you should have an operating staff who is familiar and prepared for the procedure. Should never go in the middle of the night to do this extremely demanding procedure. I was lucky enough to get a significant number of cases, and this is my study of 30 hips, which is probably the first in India. This is one of the X-rays which I had shown in the article. You can see that it's a severe slip. You can see a large amount of posteromedial callus. This is the same child after 3 years showing excellent healing and no AVN. Thus, to reiterate 10 tips, you should diagnose it well, see to it that an obese child with distal thigh pain should not be missed. The X-ray of the hip always has to be done. You should diagnose associated conditions. You should classify with the help of the three classifications. You should understand that it's a slow process. It's not a Del Bay 1 fracture. We should know the goals of treatment. You should know the options. The in situ pinning is the treatment of choice for mild to moderate slips. The PARSH method should be done with care. You should do an acute reduction till the time of the chronicity. It should not be a complete reduction. Close reduction, or at least a vigorous close reduction, should be strictly avoided. And you should know the two complex methods, the Dunn method, which is done through the anterior approach, and know about the accurate and safe method, which is the GANS modified Dunn method. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mandar. That was an excellent and comprehensive review of ACFE, including all the more modern developments that have happened in the last 5 to 10 years. Thomas, any questions from our...
Yes, we do. Yes. We have a few questions for Dr. Agache. One was, what would be the positioning of the patient in case of unilateral and bilateral in situ pinning?
So again, that depends on whether it's a stable slip or an unstable slip. If it's a very unstable slip, I would like to put the child on a fracture table. However, the fracture table positioning is extremely important. We, as mostly trauma surgeons, or the OTs are mostly trauma OTs, all the staff of the OT, they usually put the child's leg in internal rotation, or any person's leg in internal rotation once the person is put on a fracture table. Now that is extremely dangerous in case of a slipped capital femoral epiphysis. You should keep it in situ. In fact, the senior most person should hold the leg when you are positioning the child on a fracture table. So that is there for unstable slip. usually it is extremely rare for us to have a bilateral unstable slip. Usually it's an unstable slip on one side and a stable slip or a prophylactic pinning on the other side. So the other side is usually safe in order to put the child on a fracture table. If it's a stable slip on both sides, I'd like to do it on a supine table on a simple radiolucent top. And I do a frog leg or a gentle 30 degrees flexion and turn the C-arm slightly 30 degrees in order to get a good lateral view. So in case of a stable slip, I try to use a simple radiolucent top and not a fracture table. I know there are different views to it, but this is what I follow as a protocol.
Perfect. Thank you. One more question. What is the radiological difference between a Delbit type 1 and slip capital?
Yeah. So usually in the slip capital femoral epiphysis, there are secondary changes which happen in the metaphysis. So you can see that there is an anterior rounding of the metaphysis. That is extremely important. The other thing is that you can always see some form of posteromedial callus there. So it's always, it's usually quite apparent if you see a number of cases of SCFE that the rounding of the metaphysis is quite very significant. In fact, in old cases of slip capital femoral epiphysis where the history is there for many months, the entire neck is retroverted. So these sort of changes are not seen in a traumatic Delbay 1 fracture, but will be seen in a severe SCFE.
Thank you. And the last question, I think you've spoken about this already, but somebody wanted to know the indications for prophylactic pinning.
Yeah. So
I think you've just covered to reiterate, it, but sorry about that.
Yeah. So just to reiterate, any child where he's away from skeletal maturity or anything which is going to cause skeletal maturity to be delayed. So which means that there are endocrinological anomalies like hypogonadism or something of that sort, which where the skeletal maturity is going to be delayed. Or when he has more than 2 years of growth left, or when he is obese, or when he has unreliable follow-up. So these are my four indications for doing a prophylactic pinning.
Thank you very much, Dr. Agashi. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Jay, back to you.
Yeah, thanks, Mandar. So we'll move to the last presentation where I'll be speaking about the management of DDH. I'm just trying to time myself. Great. So, the main objective of DDH management is to prevent neglected DDH. It's not a life-threatening problem, but it can cause significant disability if it's not managed properly. So in India, we see X-rays like this all the time, and our aim should be to prevent this, and our talk is aimed at trying to find out what's the best way of doing that. So I like to think of DDH management in terms of this ladder of reconstruction. And you will see that there are clear-cut age groups when the treatment of DDH changes as the child gets older. So we start with children under the age of 6 months requiring a simple Pavlik harness and getting a good result. And as we go through the years into older children, you can see that the amount of intervention increases, the amount of complication increases, and the eventual outcome that we produce is not as good. So the whole aim of DDH is to try and diagnose it at the earliest age possible, preferably soon after birth. So just a quick point about prenatal development. The cartilage anlagen that eventually forms the hip joint starts to develop as early as 8 weeks of intrauterine life. We know that at 3 months, there is medial rotation of the lower limb bud. So any problems between 8 to 12 weeks of gestation will result in more severe hip problems like proximal femoral focal deficiency or congenital femoral deficiency. By 18 weeks, there is active range of movements starting in the hip as the muscles start to work. And if a child has arthrogryposis or amyoplasia, then that hinders this normal process of hip development that happens in utero, and that's what causes dislocation of the hip in children with arthrogryposis. And by the time we get to the third trimester, there is less room inside the uterus for the fetus to move around, and intrauterine position starts to influence hip development and hip position. So these are the three key prenatal stages of development of the hip that can cause a DDH or DDH-like picture. So at birth, we have two broad categories. The first are the teratologic dislocation, as I mentioned, DDH or dislocation of the hip that's associated with neuromuscular problems, arthrogryposis, and certain skeletal dysplasias. And this is quite obvious just by clinical examination because they have associated abnormalities of the knee, the foot. They may also have abnormal facies, which is suggestive of a genetic disorder. And then we have the routine DDH, where the child is otherwise clinically normal, does not have any other features other than the dislocation itself. So the incidence of DDH is dictated largely by the ethnicity of the child. Caucasians appear to have the highest incidence, and as Indians, we do have some Caucasian genes in us, so DDH is prevalent in India. But depending on the definition of DDH, the actual incidence changes from as less as 1 per 1,000 to 15 per 1,000 live births. It's very high in Native Americans because they have a cultural practice of swaddling their babies, and we look at some illustrations. And DDH is very rare in the Chinese and in the Native Africans. So this is an illustration of how babies, Native American or American Indian babies, are swaddled soon after birth, and this puts both hips into an adducted position and increases their risk of DDH. Fortunately, in India, our mothers have a cultural practice of carrying the infant on the hip. Even the more recent baby carriers places both hips into wide abduction, and this is quite good for early development of the hip. So there is a definite genetic basis to DDH, though it is not a causative factor, but it is a contributory factor. Twin studies have shown that in monozygotic twins, the concordance rate is almost 10 times that what you see in dizygotic twins. And Wynne Davies, who is a geneticist who has done a lot of this population-based DDH work, has shown that familial joint laxity and primary acetabular dysplasia is also known to be transmitted through genetic route. So risk factors are essentially environmental factors that, in addition to the genetic cause, results in DDH. 60% of DDH babies are first born. 80% of DDH happens in girl babies, and this is because they are more susceptible to progesterone and relaxin, which are secreted by the placenta and by the maternal circulation in the third trimester, and this also affects female babies more than male babies. Breech presentation is another significant risk factor. You can see in the second slide, second picture, that in a breech presentation, the hips of the baby are actually engaged into the true pelvis, and this reduces the amount of space that is available for the hips to move in the third trimester. And the left occipital anterior presentation, which is the commonest, places the left hip of the baby against the mother's spine. And this again increases the incidence of left DDH compared to the right side. Positive family history is another significant risk factor. If you have a first degree relative with DDH, your risk goes up by 12 times. So if you have a sibling, the risk is 1 in 17. If you have a parent, it's 1 in 8. And if a parent and sibling are affected, then 1 in 3 babies will have DDH. This is almost 300 times the population incidence of DDH, which is 1 in 1,000. So a positive family history has a significant correlation with risk of DDH. The other risk factors which we take into account is if there is a history of clinical instability. And all babies who are born undergo a hip examination at birth by the pediatrician. It can also be done incidentally by a GP or an orthopedic surgeon. If the baby has the family of the baby, they have a cultural practice of swaddling the baby, keeping the hips tightly together and wrapping the baby up. That again places the hip in adduction and increases the risk. There are certain associations with DDH. Foot deformities at birth, like a calcaneal valgus foot or club foot, can increase the risk of the baby having DDH as well. And torticollis also has a positive association. There are certain classic pathological anatomical features that are described, and I think all postgraduates should have this information at their fingertips. There are intracapsular factors and extracapsular factors. Intracapsular factors include an inverted labrum. As the femoral head dislocates, it pushes the labrum down. Normally, the labrum is everted. We have the hypertrophied ligamentum teres. We have a pulvinar, which is fibrofatty tissue in the acetabulum, and this can prevent reduction when you're trying to effect the reduction of the hip. There is an hourglass constriction of the capsule, and this is because the psoas tendon starts to go medial to the capsule, and it causes a constriction of the capsule. And we have a tight transverse acetabular ligament, because the acetabulum does not volumetrically widen because the hip femoral head is no longer present inside it. As the femoral head leaves the acetabulum becomes shrunk, and the transverse acetabular ligament is a significant structure that holds the acetabulum with a narrow AP width. Extracapsular factors, like I mentioned, is a tight psoas. The adductor longus tendon can also be tight. And along with the dislocation, there is also shallowness of the acetabulum, which is called acetabular dysplasia, and there can also be increased femoral antiversion. So, like I mentioned in my first few slides, diagnosis and management of DDH is dictated largely by the age at presentation. So we will look at it in terms of different ages and how we manage DDH differently at different times. So birth to 6 months, DDH is diagnosed based on three factors. First is the history, which is the risk factors we looked at. Clinical examination, the Barlow and Ottolani test, which I think everyone knows about. And then we use ultrasound examination, because that's an ultrasound picture of the hip. Let's try and understand what that is. So this is a picture of how the proximal femoral anatomy changes over time. You can see that at birth, up to 4 months of age, almost the entire proximal femur is cartilaginous. So let's look at that cartilaginous femur next to the ultrasound picture. What you're seeing on the ultrasound is actually this entire cartilaginous portion. And the bony portion, you do not see on ultrasound, because all the ultrasound waves are bounced back at the chondroosseous border. So Barlow test is a provocative test of dislocation. My fellow told me that easy way to remember Barlow is Bahar Lao, which means you push the hip out. So here the hip is at rest. It is inside the joint, but it is unstable. And when you flex, adduct, and compress the thigh, the hip will actually come out of the joint and you can feel that clunk. The Ottolani is a reduction test. And here the hip at rest is dislocated, and by flexing the hip to 90, by lifting up on the greater trochanter and abducting the hip gently, you are trying to push the hip back in. And as the femoral head goes over the posterior labrum, you can feel the clunk of reduction. Asymmetric skin folds are again useful in older children. Up to perhaps the age of 10 or 11 months, you can see these asymmetrical groin fold. Asymmetrical thigh folds are not as significant. Asymmetric limb length, again, is in older children. You keep the knees and hips flexed together at 45 degrees, keep the heels together, and you can see a difference in the knee height. And this is called the Galeazzi test. Limited abduction of the hip is the most reliable clinical sign in children older than 3 months. Because by 3 months, the Barlow and Ottolani tests start to become unreliable or even negative. So limitation of hip abduction is a very reliable clinical sign. But if you have bilateral DDH, there is no asymmetry, and that could lead to misleading clinical findings. Which is more predictive? If an infant has a positive risk factor on the history, DDH is 3 times more likely. If you have an abnormal clinical examination, it is 16 times more likely. So clinical examination is more predictive of abnormality than history. But when both are present, obviously the accuracy increases. So that is about clinical examination. The next tool we have at our disposal is the ultrasound. And there are two major methods. The first is the static method, as popularized by Graf. and the dynamic method, which was devised by Harkey. Some units use a combined approach, but the majority of pediatric orthopedic centers use the static or graph method. So what is the graph method? It is essentially a coronal plane section of the hip through the maximum diameter of the hip joint through the triradiate cartilage. And we will look at, we'll try and understand this ultrasound image better. So that is the lateral wall of the ilium on the ultrasound and on the picture. That is the bony roof, that is the lower limb of the ilium. That is the cartilaginous roof. That's the femoral head, which is sitting in its normal position. So we measure the, what is the angle made by the bony roof to the ilium, and that is called the alpha angle. And we measure what is the cartilaginous, what is the angle that the cartilaginous roof makes to the, again, to the lateral wall of the ilium, and this is called the beta angle. Normal value of alpha angle is 60 degrees and above, and normal values of the beta angle, the cartilaginous roof, should be less than 55 degrees. So higher the alpha angle, the better it is. Lower the beta angle, again, the better it is. So based on graph classification, right now the graph classification has become very detailed, but for PGs, I think you just need to remember these four major subdivisions of the graph classification. A graph type 1 hip is a normal hip where the alpha angle is more than 60 degrees. A graph 2A or 2B hip is an immature hip where the alpha angle is less than 60 degrees. So 2A is when the child is less than 3 months of age. 2B is when the child is more than 3 months of age. A type 3 hip is a decentered hip. And this is when the alpha angle is less than 43 degrees. And here the hip is starting to come out of the joint. And a type 4 hip is a completely dislocated hip. And I think if you know these four major categories in the graph classification, I think that is perfectly adequate. So based on clinical examination at birth, we have four scenarios. The hip joint can be inside the joint and stable. You can have risk factors or you may not have risk factors. It may be in the joint, but it is dislocatable. And this is a balo-positive hip. It can be dislocated hip and reducible, which is an Ortolani-positive hip. Or you can have a dislocated and irreducible hip. And the management is based on which of these categories it belongs to. If the hip is in joint and stable, no immediate intervention is required. If you have risk factors, then you need to do an ultrasound scan to make sure that there is no underlying hip dysplasia. If you have an unstable hip, which is a balo or an Ortolani positive hip, the consensus would be to start treatment with Pavlik harness. If it's a dislocated or irreducible hip, you can do a trial of Pavlik harness or an abduction brace. And if that is unsuccessful, then you may have to move to the more invasive approach. Based on ultrasound, there are only, this is the expanded graph classification. You can see lots of subtypes, but just remember simply up to 2A, these are all normal or physiologically immature hips. And these can be managed by just observation and ultrasound monitoring. And the treatment threshold to start treatment with Pavlik harness based on ultrasound is from 2B onwards. So any hip that is higher than 2B on the graph classification will require some form of treatment. But a negative hip ultrasound does not preclude anomalies. So if you have any clinical suspicion, it's always best to repeat the ultrasound after a period of time, say 4 to 6 weeks, and make sure that you have an anatomically normal, stable hip. So this is an example of a Pavlik harness, a baby in a Pavlik harness. I'll just go through the various parts of the harness. You have a shoulder strap, you have a chest strap, you have a flexion strap, a shin strap, and a soft booty. So these are the parts of the Pavlik harness. And then you have an abduction strap at the back. And by adjusting these, the tension in these various straps, you can position the hip in any place you would like. So a simple management protocol in Pavlik harness would be to ensure that the hip is concentrically reduced by ultrasound monitoring within 3 to 4 weeks. If you get concentric reduction, then you keep the harness on for about 6 weeks and then gradually wean it off. If the hip is not concentrically reduced, by certainly 3 weeks, we would abandon the harness treatment. Harness treatment is extremely successful with 97% success rate overall in DDH. And if you have a dislocated hip at birth, the success rate is still 85%. And it has a very low complication rate. So the complications of Pavlik harness include avascular necrosis, which is because of excessive abduction. There can be persistent acetabular dysplasia. So all children with DDH, even if they are successfully managed with Pavlik harness, should be radiographically monitored up to skeletal maturity. Femoral nerve palsy can happen if there is excessive hip flexion, and harness can fail. And the rates of failure in different series is somewhere between 5 and 40%. So Pavlik harness is a safe, effective, patient-friendly, parent-friendly, and surgeon-friendly tool. But ultrasound monitoring during the treatment is essential to success. And one needs to continue with X-ray follow-up to make sure that the child doesn't develop persistent acetabular dysplasia. The other device that we frequently use are static hip abduction braces. And this is an example that we use in our practice. You also have the Freyka pillow, the Rhino Cruiser, the Von Rosen splint, and the Ilfeld orthosis. And all of these devices, I think you should be aware, just by looking at them, you should be able to at least identify what sort of brace it is. Example of a successful harness treatment. This is a baby who had initial Pavlik harness and then followed with a hip abduction brace. This is at 6 months, at 12 months, and by 24 months, you can see that there is concentric stable reduction with good development of the femoral ossific nucleus. When we go to the slightly older age group, children beyond 6 months of age, this is when we start to get X-rays, and one needs to be very familiar with how to interpret the X-ray. There is upward lateral displacement of the femoral head. You have the four quadrants formed by the Hilgenreiner and the Perkins line, and a dislocated hip will be in the upper outer quadrant. There is delayed appearance of the ossific nucleus. You can see that the ossific nucleus on the right hip is smaller than the left side. You get a V-shaped figure of the teardrop. Normally you have a U-shaped teardrop, and teardrop is basically the radiographic feature that you see on the medial wall of the acetabulum. In DDH, you get a V-shaped teardrop. There is a break in the Shenton's line, which is obvious in this X-ray. You have a steep acetabular slope, and anything more than 30 degrees is considered as significantly abnormal. So in a baby at 6 months of age, we do examination of anesthesia, followed by an arthrogram with closed reduction and hip spica. And the hip spica is maintained anywhere from 6 weeks to 6 months. So we use a subadductor approach to visualize the femoral head. The medial dipole has to be less than 5 millimeters. There should be more than 50% coverage of the femoral head, and we should see a good contour-labeled complex. So when we see these three features, we call it a concentric reduction. So the prerequisites for a successful closed reduction are concentric reduction and a wide safe zone. Wide safe zone, when the hip is in adduction, there is a risk of redislocation. If we excessively abduct it, we get avascular necrosis. And safe zone is the portion of the range of movement of the femoral head that is in between these two extremes. You can add an adducted tenotomy if you have a narrow safe zone in order to increase it. A CT scan is mandatory after a closed reduction. So we draw the ischial line, and the two femoral heads have to be anterior to this. So this is an example of an 11-month-old girl. This is 1 year post-op and 18 months post-op. She's got mild AVN, but you can see that the hip is concentrically reduced. This is an example of a failed closed reduction. That's the femoral head, that's the acetabulum. There is overlap, and there is a wild medial dipole. And in these cases, we will go to a open reduction. Open reduction is also done in children who present at older than 12 months of age. So when we do it, when there is non-concentric reduction or in the older child, or if there is a narrow safe zone. Whether to wait for the ossific nucleus to appear was a question which I think has not now been answered, with many studies showing that ossific nucleus does not protect against AVN. So the medial open reduction can be done through various approaches which use intervals between the adductor muscles, Ferguson, modified Ferguson, Ludloff, etc. So the pathological anatomy of DDH, in the younger child, only the lower factors are abnormal, ligamentum teres, pulvinar, hourglass constriction, and the transverse acetabular ligament and the medial open reduction is satisfactory to address these factors. So is an example of older child who underwent a medial open reduction, 12 months follow-up and 24 months follow-up shows good reduction with no AVM. So in the child who is older than 1.5 years, a medial open reduction is not really advised because the hip has been out for a long time and these are walking children. So they have a very lax capsule and it may be difficult to achieve a reduction through the medial approach. So we use the anterior open reduction. We do this through the bikini incision, Smith-Peterson approach. We perform a SOAS sternotomy, a T-capsulotomy. We remove the blocks to reduction, which we discussed earlier, reduce the hip, and then perform a capsulorraphy to secure the reduction. So anterior open reduction, the position of stability is abduction and internal rotation. Some surgeons prefer to do a varus derotation osteotomy at 4 to 6 weeks after the open reduction. Now, DDH is not always associated with femoral antiversion, so it's good not to routinely derotate. And if it is a tight reduction, we do a measure of femoral shortening so that the hip does not redislocate. Pelvic osteotomies are of various types, redirectional osteotomies, which change the orientation of the acetabulum. We can have a volume reducing procedure, which are the acetabuloplasties, or you can have salvage procedures. So in children less than 7 years of age, we do the Salter, which is a redirectional osteotomy, or a Pemberton or a Degas, which are reorientation osteotomies, which change the acetabular volume. So the Pemberton is an anterior acetabuloplasty and a Degas is a lateral acetabuloplasty. In an older child, if the triradiate cartilage is open, we do a Degas or a triple. And if the triradiate cartilage is closed, we have to do a Bernese osteotomy, and we'll see examples of this. Where a concentric reduction cannot be achieved, we have to go for a salvage procedure. So this is an example of a Pemberton osteotomy. You can see the greater sciatic notch and the hip joint and the triradiate cartilage in the middle. And the osteotome is basically aiming for the middle of the triradiate cartilage. We keep the osteotomy levered open and then place a bone graft in the middle and sometimes secure to the wire. And that's a bone model example of how to do a Pemberton osteotomy. After an anterior open reduction, typically we immobilize in hip spica for about 8 to 10 weeks in a position of 30 degrees of abduction, flexion, and internal rotation. So this is an example of a child, 12-month-old child who had an anterior open reduction at 6 months post-op, and that's 7 years post-op, she's got some residual acetabular dysplasia. And last year we did a varus derotation femoral osteotomy and an acetabuloplasty to correct it. So many children who undergo DDS treatment at a younger age may require further corrective surgery for residual acetabular dysplasia, and this is as high as 40% in some series. In the older child, we have to do lengthy and complex procedures, femoral shortening, derotation, a little bit of varus, and acetabuloplasty, depending on the direction of the dysplasia. So this is a child who had reduction at 8 years. This is when she's 15 years old, and she came to me with all her athletic medals. DDH, unilateral DDH in the older child can be disabling because they end up with a large leg length discrepancy. And these can also be reduced in the, but these are all complex operations that should be done only by experts. The last entity is silent hip dysplasia, where the hip has been in joint, but there is just acetabular dysplasia, and these can become symptomatic in the teenage years. So these require what we call a Gans osteotomy, where you do an incomplete ischial osteotomy, you do a pubic osteotomy, and then a angulated iliac osteotomy. You mobilize the acetabulum, leaving the posterior column intact, and then you fix it stably with screws. And this is 6 months post-op showing good reduction of the hip and good coverage. So salvage operations are largely not done for DDH. We prefer to use them in other situations such as CP. This is a non-walking child with CP, and I've done a Chiari osteotomy just to give a stable coverage for the hip. Shelf procedure is again another salvage procedure, which this is a historical X-ray from about 10 years ago. We no longer do these operations for DDH, preferring to put articular cartilage on articular cartilage. All the salvage procedures basically depend upon the labrum and the capsule to undergo cartilage metaplasia, and they don't really last in the long term. So I won't go into the IHDI classification. I would recommend everyone look at this website, hipdysplasia.org. There are lots of features and lots of resources for physicians. So if you have some free time, There's a lot of reading material. So just to summarize, the management of DDH is largely dictated by age. The earlier we are able to diagnose DDH, the better the prognosis. Thank you so much.
Hi, Jay. Thank you for that excellent lecture. Thank you very much for that. I think it was very comprehensive, covered, management of DDH in different age groups. We're sort of short of time. So we just have 5 minutes, Jay. So I don't know whether the quiz thing is going to work.
Okay.
Yeah. But there is one question for you. Somebody wants to know the uses, advantages and disadvantages of the bikini incision.
So the bikini incision is a versatile approach, and it is a preferred incision now for all anterior hip surgery. The previous Smith-Peterson approach, where we used to take a longitudinal incision down the thigh, it is not very cosmetic. And I think most surgeons have moved to using the bikini incision. But once we go through the bikini skin incision, then inside we use the Smith-Peterson approach, the standard exposure. But I think most of the hip surgeries can be done without the need for the distal longitudinal extension down the thigh.
Thank you. Thank you, Jay. I think we don't have any more questions come up. So, and we're nearly out of time also. I think we've got a message from Neeraj saying that we are about to overshoot our time. So can we call it a day? Can we end up? So I'd like to thank all the faculty for taking their time off. Dr. Jayant Sampath for organizing this session. Dr. Hitesh Shah, thank you very much. Dr. Rudra Prasad, thank you. Dr. Agashe, thank you very much for taking time off to teach postgraduates. I thank Dr. Ashok Sham and Dr. Neeraj Bijlani from Ortho TV for helping us with the live streaming of this teaching program. And I thank all the PGs for attending. We don't know what the numbers are, but I thank you all for attending. I'm sure you've enjoyed the session. If you have any doubts or questions to ask, you can ask on the WhatsApp groups or in any of the social media that you're part of. And just to announce the next session, it's on the 18th of September. And we're going to cover the knee joint. So we're going to start with examination of the knee, radiological, how to read X-rays and MRIs, and meniscal injuries, ligamentous injuries, as well as an approach to a painful knee. Oh, with that, I thank you all. And with that, we come to the end of the program. Thank you very much, Jay. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Everybody.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks.
Bye, Jay. Bye.
Thank you, everybody.
Bye.
Thanks.